Good evening again, everyone. And the final item of business is a members' business debate on motion S5M23483 in the name of David Stewart on the Highlands and Islands Medical Service. And this debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Would those members who wish to speak in the debate please put the R in the chat box, and I call on David Stewart to open the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will retire. So could I thank all members who have signed my motion, and for those that have not, I warmly welcome all sinners that care to repent. Establishment of the medical service in 1913 was, in my view, the greatest in the history of the region. So just picture the scene. Nurses riding push bikes and motorbikes, cutting across some of the most difficult terrain in the country. Doctors, sleeves rolled up, strong arms at the oars, moving from one scattered and rural population to another. Navigating from place to place by a simple but one great effort to bring care and treatment to people in what would later become recognised as the world's first provision of state-funded healthcare. Bringing medicine, bringing creams and critically medical expertise to the super rural here at all. And its practices and principles were to become the bedrock, the very foundation health service was created. The Highlands and Islands Medical Service came into being after it was discovered exempt from the 1911 National Health. It meant that many people...
Excuse me, Mr. Stewart. Your sound is very bad, and we're finding it difficult to pick up properly. Can I suggest that you turn your camera off, and it may improve your sound? Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So, chaired by Sir John Dewar, the Dewar Report of 1912 sought to understand the impact of an income was having across the region. Now, this was no armchair exercise. His large team travelled across Highlands and Islands, engaging and listening with communities in Inverness, Orkney, Shetland, Lewis, Skye, Oban, and many other settlements. It's difficult to exaggerate the enormity of the task with the inadequate transfer infrastructure that was available then back in the early part of the 20th century. Doctors, crofters, fishermen and others were consulted across the region. It was found out that the geography of the Highlands and Islands was proving problematic, both for doctors to treat people, for patients. It meant diets were poor, homes were damp and disease was rife, spreading from livestock. Many people died needlessly. And here's an extract from the evidence of Dr. James Najur report, and I quote, "What do you blame? To begin with, there's no foundation for the children. At the age of 3 months, the reason for that is the milk of the cows is given to the calves, and there's no milk for the children. It's a case of survival of the Dewar report was to change lives for the better. Its philosophy was that income, class or geography should not be barriers to receiving. The establishment of a minimum wage for doctors, funding for more district nursing associations and the standardisation in the cost of doctors' visits, regardless of distance. The government approved these recommendations, and the Highlands and Islands Medical Service was swiftly established in August 1913 and handed an annual grant of £42,000 a year. That's worth over £1 million today. Good value for money. The service was a rousing success, and the grant provided accommodation, transport, further study and holidays for healthcare workers, and the standard of healthcare began to exceed. These successes were detailed in the committee, which was a review of the state of Scotland's healthcare systems. And I quote, "On the basis of the family doctor, there has been built up a flexible central administration system of cooperative effort, embracing the central department, private GPs, nursing associations, voluntary hospitals, specialists, local authorities and others to meet the medical needs of the people. Additional funding from the Treasury in the 1930s led to a further expansion of the service. Stornoway now had a surgeon, as did Wick, before Shetland and Orkney in 1934. And by 1935, the first air ambulance service, the first patient ambulance, was fisherman John McDermott in 1933. He was in urgent need of a stomach operation that couldn't wait for travel by sea or road. An hour after he was lifted in Islay, Mr. McDermott arrived in the West, where he was treated. And by 1948, the air ambulance service was carrying 275 patients a year. Across the Highlands and Islands, half of Scotland's landmass, were able to improve their quality of life, social mobility and community spirit. By the time the NHS was established in 1948 by the Attlee Labour government, the Highlands and Islands Medical Service was 35 years. And the rest of the Highlands Islands was able to learn by the successes of communities all across the Highlands and Islands. The early pioneers of 1913 deserve our praise, admiration and recognition. I've no doubt, and Nye Bevan, in the concept of the National Health Service of use. Not for the first time, the Highlands and Islands provided inspiration and leadership with a philosophy of better to light one candle than to forever. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. We made out most of what you were saying to us, Mr. Stewart, but it was quite difficult at times. I wonder if you have the basis of your contribution online, if you could please email it through, and we will make sure all the members participating get a copy of it, and of course the official report. Thank you. We'll move on now to the open debate and speeches of around 4 minutes, please. And first of all, Alistair Allen, followed by Edward Mountain. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will switch off Outlook to avoid any undue irritation. Presiding Officer, can I firstly thank David Stewart for bringing this motion to the Parliament today? It's a worthy motion to discuss, and I feel the need to preface my words with a health warning of sorts, as I am not a medical expert. In reading through, as I did, the 1912 Dewar report into health in the Highlands, the subject of our debate today, there was one witness above any other with whom I readily identified. This was the crofter in North Uist who fainted while holding up a tallow candle for a visiting doctor who was operating on his neighbour's strangulated hernia. This and other episodes recorded in this remarkable report to the UK Parliament give us a perspective into the huge geographical challenges which health services have had to overcome then, and to an extent even now in this part of Scotland. They also, as others have pointed out, serve to remind us that the Dewar report led to the then unimaginably radical conclusion that only a health service free at the point of need was ever likely to work. That led to the creation of the Highlands and Islands Medical Service, which 35 years later, at least arguably, provided the model for the NHS itself. Now, that the Highlands and Islands were poorly served for health services in 1912 is a fairly monumental understatement. The Dewar report exposed what had been a chronic political failure to deal with that problem at any point throughout the famines and clearances of the preceding century. And as Mr. Stewart set out, the report describes a time only just beyond living memory when large areas of the Highlands and Islands had neither roads nor telephones. The few doctors who existed were so poorly paid that they had to charge fees to cover their frequent need to hire boats and horses. One doctor in Lewis describes trying to serve a scattered population of 7,000 people in his district on foot. Now, given that the average income of a crofter in the Western Isles after rent varied from place to place at that time from between £10 and £26 per annum, doctors were, for appreciable reasons, often only called when it was too late. Now, many people in the islands testified to the inquiry about this injustice, including memorably Father McNeil in Eriski, who complained about the lack of medical care on that island. He pointed out that the schoolmaster was having to attend the births of babies, quote, with the aid of a medical dictionary. Another witness testified that in parts of the Hebrides, people were walking 30 miles just to search out the powers of a seventh son of a seventh son for want of any other available medical option. The Duer Commission's recommendations were enacted not long before another global pandemic, and its recommendations were radical indeed, a health service free at the point of need. These ideas were implemented in the Highlands and Islands, and 35 years later, as I say, they formed the basis, I believe, of the NHS throughout Scotland. So it's right that we mark this historic anniversary and the way this event transformed the lives of people in my constituency and elsewhere. It's an opportunity too to recognise the unique challenges that health services face on islands and other areas of scattered population, and to pay tribute to the work which health and care services continue to do today in challenging circumstances sometimes, to make Duer's hopes a reality today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Edward Mountain's been having some connectivity problems. So I'm going to move now to Stuart Stevenson, please, and then to Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've bypassed my domestic broadband failure by being out in my car and using my phone to connect you. So that will work, I know perfectly well. But more fundamentally, I sit looking out over the very last of the sun, over the Murray Firth to the Highlands, and the area from which my father came as he was born and brought up in the Bell. My main hobby these days is genealogy, and so therefore I look at many of the certificates, particularly death certificates, of my ancestors and the ancestors of other friends. And what is quite remarkable when you look at the cause of death of many people in the Highlands into quite modern times, it will simply say general debility, no medical attendant. In other words, there were no medical people to tend to people at the end of their life, and I know perfectly well at other points in their life. So the Highlands and Islands Medical Service was a quite remarkable and visionary attempt to right the wrongs of access to proper healthcare that had been wholly absent from people right across rural areas of Scotland. One of the early appointments was to send a community nurse to Hirta, to St Kilda, just in time for the First World War to break out. So the world in which my father was born into in 1904 in the Highlands was a fundamentally different environment from that which we have today. And indeed, every decade has seen the health service and health provision in Highland areas and across Scotland and beyond change. My very first dentist, for example, had no medical qualifications whatsoever, and so couldn't prescribe and couldn't give anaesthesia when he was working on teeth in your mouth. So the Highlands Islands Medical Service was a really remarkable visionary step that came from the Liberal government that there was at that time, that introduced the national insurance system that provided people with a pension for the first time. Para Handy, in one of his imaginary tales written over 100 years ago, talks about pension farming. And he also talks about medical provision in the Highlands and Islands in the coastal trade that that he and the crew sailed around our coasts. So David Stewart, I particularly congratulate for bringing this to Parliament. He, like myself, is coming to the end of his parliamentary career, as others are, Presiding Officer. So this will probably be the last debate that he leads. And I think if that is so, there is no finer way for a parliamentarian of some considerable distinction, albeit I have not agreed with him on every possible subject, to go out on a high aiming this important topic to Parliament. Today, we have a health service that's modelled on that experience. Without it, we would probably not have had what we now take for granted in the NHS in Scotland today. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenson, for your commitment to going out and sitting in your car. And we'll now hear from Lewis MacDonald, followed by Gail Ross.
Mr. Presiding Officer, I too congratulate David Stewart on securing this debate, and I echo the remarks made there by Stuart Stevenson towards the end of his comments. David Stewart won his first parliamentary election 24 years ago, albeit to a different parliament, and in all that time, his commitment to the Highlands and Islands and to campaigning to improve public health have been plain for all to see. So it is indeed a very apt topic for a members' business debate in David Stewart's name, because the story we celebrate today is one of public service and of promoting public health in the Highlands and Islands. We should never forget that the creation of the Highlands and Islands Medical Service was a result of the absence of a cash economy and the challenge for doctors to make a living in the Crofton counties at that time. Clearances and emigration had created some of the most sparsely populated areas in Western Europe. Crofters had gained the vote for the first time in the 1880s. A Crofters party sent MPs to Westminster, and Crofting land rights were secured, ending the clearances. But this remained a subsistence economy, not one, as Alistair Allen said, where patients could readily lay their hands on cash to meet medical fees. As the Edinburgh Medical Journal put it in 1911, the districts are enormous, the population very thin and very poor, and means of communication are few. And as Maurice McRae wrote in 2003 in his History of the Origins and Ideals of the National Health Service in Scotland, no doctor in the Highlands could easily afford to buy a car or a motorboat, although in many cases he needed both. If Victorian and Edwardian Britain relied on the market to provide medical services, here was a classic case of market failure. Private practice could not sustain general practitioners in the Highlands, and the very limited services funded by local ratepayers or by charities could not hope to fill the gap. Once the law provided every British citizen with a right of access to medical services under the National Insurance Act, the only way to deliver that in the Highlands and Islands was to set up a public medical service. My father and his brothers grew up in the Hebrides in the 1920s and 1930s. Those were hard and often hungry times. Traditional remedies which had sustained people for generations could still be found, but the Highlands and Islands Medical Service had begun to bring modern scientific and medical knowledge to the service of even the most remote communities. By the end of the 1920s, the number of GPs in the Highlands and Islands had increased from 100 to 165, now on secured incomes, with, as David Stewart said, a minimum guaranteed. The service had also funded jobs and homes for nearly 200 district nurses, often with small hospices attached to the house and with bikes or motorbikes for that job of going from home to home across vast rural areas. And the next decision was to go beyond primary care and to invest state funds in what had previously been charitable or cottage hospitals. A full-time consultant surgeon was funded by the Highlands and Islands Medical Service in Stornoway from 1924. During my father's childhood, it became possible for the first time for Crofting families to access both outpatient and inpatient services, as a matter of course, without leaving the Western Isles, with huge benefits for all, from the cradle to the grave. The Highlands and Islands Medical Service served its region for a generation. The next generation built the National Health Service on the same principles and with the same transformational impact on public health. So as we celebrate the NHS today for all that it continues to do, David Stewart has done us all a service by reminding us of where it all began. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will now move to Gail Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, this debate certainly has been unintentionally entertaining so far. As others have done, I would also like to thank my colleague David Stewart in bringing this motion forward for debate. At a time where the value of our NHS is so dearly felt, I think it's very appropriate that we reflect on the pioneering work carried out in the Highlands and Islands 35 years before the creation of the NHS in 1948. And I would also like to recognise the contribution David Stewart has made to the Highlands and Islands over many years. And I wish him well in whatever he chooses to do next. He certainly has been a source of advice and information for me. But to go back to the topic at hand, we do owe so much to those who campaigned, lobbied, and created a service which brought affordable healthcare and support for clinicians and communities alike over a century ago. And I believe that their work had a massive influence on the creation of what we now take for granted in healthcare. Many others in this debate have mentioned the Dewar report, which led to the creation of this pioneering service. And I would like to focus on the legacy that this service has left in many of our communities. In many communities throughout the Highlands and Islands, you will still see homes referred to as the nurse's house or the doctor's house. And whilst very few of these remain as homes for medics, they still stand as a testament to the recognition that healthcare in remote rural Scotland has many different requirements from those in urban settings. And housing was identified as a key factor in retaining and supporting medical practitioners. And this is still relevant today. In my home county of Caithness and throughout the constituency of Caithness, Sutherland and Ross, quality affordable housing for healthcare professionals remains a key issue. While steps are being made in the right direction to address this issue, it really does show how thorough and forward-thinking the Highlands and Islands Medical Service was. Another legacy was the funding and creation of many small hospitals. For example, in 1920, the Cottage Hospital in Invergordon was acquired from the Royal Navy and repurposed as an infectious disease hospital. And now the County Community Hospital, it's a vital, important part of the health and social care infrastructure in Easter Ross, born from the legacy of its predecessor. And indeed, Presiding Officer, in the early part of the 20th century, there were over 60 small hospitals throughout the mainland Highlands, providing a range of services. Excuse me. Public health and healthcare in general has definitely come a long way over the last century, as we all know. And it's almost hard to believe now that hospitals had to be constructed specifically to deal with outbreaks of disease. For example, smallpox. There was a smallpox hospital which had to be built in Wick and operated for almost 30 years. And I'm definitely happy to report that smallpox is certainly not an issue in the town anymore. Our population is far healthier than it has been in the past, and science and technology have improved healthcare immeasurably over the years. But the questions over the provision of service still remain. And the question that is continuously being scrutinised is mainly, are centralised units better able to care for patients, or should patients from remote rural communities expect more of their treatment to be delivered closer to home? The Highlands and Islands to this day are continuing their tradition of pioneering service. NHS Near Me was created and developed in NHS Highland and is now supporting and treating patients throughout the country. And without it, many of us, even in this Parliament, would have been unable to attend medical appointments during the course of this pandemic. And it's true that the Highlands and Islands have been pivotal in transforming our NHS in many ways over the years. So the debates over funding and resources for remote rural healthcare, begun by the pioneers of the Highlands and Islands Medical Service, continue to this day, and I suspect they will for some time to come as well. But one thing that's certainly not in question is that the NHS is still supporting, caring and helping our communities. And for that, they deserve our heartfelt thanks. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. Now, we were trying very hard, as was Mr. Edward Mountain, to be able to hear his contribution tonight. But it seems like that's impossible because there are connectivity problems from his location. So I'm afraid I'm going to have to go straight on to the Minister now, and I'm I'm sure we're all very upset at not hearing from Mr. Mount. Can I call the Minister, please, for around 7 minutes? Marie Gouchon.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I really want to thank David Stewart for bringing forward this debate. It has been a really enjoyable debate, actually, and to listen to everyone's contributions. And I would thank everyone that's taken part in it, because it's been a really fascinating debate, actually. And I think it's really important that we reflect on and celebrate the innovation of Scotland and Scotland's people. The Dewar Committee's report led the way in establishing a new model for health and healthcare provision in the Highlands and Islands, and that the Highlands and Islands Medical Services consider the model for the NHS, just as others have said throughout their contributions tonight, is really poignant at this time. The world-class care that NHS in Scotland is providing during the pandemic just demonstrates how far the healthcare system has progressed since the Dewar report. The report set down solid foundations for the provision of healthcare for people living in remote and rural areas, foundations that have continuing resonance today, providing the basis from which we've responded to the COVID-19 pandemic. And I hope that the Dewar Committee would have welcomed the fact that the latest budget will support the safe and sustainable recovery of the NHS, with record funding in excess of £16 billion, an increase of over £800 million in core health and sport funding to allow investment of £11.9 billion in health boards. And that includes £1.9 billion for primary care, spend in excess of £1.1 billion for mental health services. Now, not only has much changed in the provision of health and healthcare services since 1912, much has changed since this Parliament marked the centenary year of the report in 2012. And I'd like to highlight the commitments that this government has made towards three key areas of remote and rural healthcare. And these are in the areas of general practice and technology and the National Islands Plan. So since the agreement of the GP contract offer in 2018, we've significantly expanded the recruitment incentives for rural GP posts across Scotland. We've increased GP relocation packages and widened their eligibility to all remote and rural practices. We want to make general practice an even more attractive career option, and we funded bursaries for GP speciality trainees who take up posts in remote and rural areas in Scotland. And these bursaries have helped distribute trainees even more evenly across Scotland. Since 2016, we've supported the Scottish Rural Medical Collaborative to develop recruitment and sustainability measures, and that included our support to the Rediscover the Joy in General Practice project. Now, that project has so far seen 33 doctors recruited to work up to 18 weeks a year in remote and rural areas. And in addition to that, ScotGEM, Scotland's first graduate entry medicine programme, focuses on careers in general practice and remote and rural working. Now, you could argue that the Scottish Government's remote and rural working group, chaired by Sir Lewis Ritchie, is actually our modern day Dewar Committee. That group was established to consider how rural GP practices can best be supported to deliver the new GP contract and strengthen their sustainability. Sir Lewis published his report of the work of the group in January last year, and the Cabinet Secretary had no hesitation in accepting its recommendations, and that included the establishment of a national centre for remote and rural health and social care to foster and promote innovation and excellence within Scotland and internationally. Digital technology was, of course, unknown when John Dewar and his committee colleagues wrote their report, and the use of digital technology to support people to remain independent or manage their condition from home has been a priority in Scotland for a long time, and it's been absolutely key to our COVID response. The virtual appointment system, NHS Near Me, has been crucial in ensuring people can access healthcare during this past year. It's seen a significant increase in usage, going from 300 consultations per week to 21,000 consultations. And feedback on that has been really positive, and we expect that to be a core part of delivering modern health and care services as we move forward. The IT challenges remain a significant issue, as we can see from the debate earlier this evening, without everyone being able to take part. And so they're obviously an issue in being able to deliver digital health and care services. The Connecting Scotland programme aims to support 50,000 of the most vulnerable people in Scotland to access digital services by accessing digital devices, through learning and through skills and connectivity. Now, finally, I would just come to the National Islands Plan. So, as with rural mainland communities, we know that good quality healthcare underpins living on Scotland's islands, and there are many good examples of excellent provision that are set out in the National Islands Plan. Health and wellbeing is at the very heart of the plan, and that's why we've committed to work with NHS Board, local authorities and health and social care partnerships to ensure that there is fair, accessible healthcare for those that live on our islands. And just in closing, Presiding Officer, the fact that we are here today debating a report from 1912 just demonstrates the continuing influence and impact that Sir John and his colleagues have had on Scottish healthcare. Remote and rural healthcare has improved immeasurably since that time, and as we emerge from the COVID pandemic, our vision for world-class healthcare in Scotland remains. We will continue to protect the NHS and provide the necessary investment and planning to ensure that our healthcare system goes from strength to strength. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That concludes the debate, and this meeting is now closed.